Hello everybody and welcome to Wine Library TV. I am your host, guest show, aka the internet's most passionate wine program. And as you can see, my first guest of, you were kind of my first guest of 2009. You didn't jump in, and Ian was here. What am I talking about? I'm a loss. But my first non-Wine Library member, guest of 2009 is here, a gentleman that I know a little bit more about than I think he even realizes, and I have respected his work from afar, but I'm going to let him introduce himself to you, the Vayner Nation. He's got the nice little Vayner Nation wristband on. Why don't you tell the Vayniacs out there who you are and why you're sitting here?
Okay, I'm Hendrik Thoma, I'm from Hamburg, Germany, and I'm a great admirer of Gary's work.
Tremendous reason for being here.
You're a cool man, I mean, you know. And I'm a master sommelier. We have two master sommeliers in Germany, and I thought, hey, when I'm in the United States, my wife, she's from Napa Valley, and I come to New York, I visit you, and we're gonna do a German wine tasting.
I love it, I love
it. Come on!
So when did you first reach out? I'm trying to remember now. A couple months ago, right?
Yeah,
in the fall. Yeah. So why don't you tell the Vayniacs, I think it's very interesting, as a master sommelier, only two in all of Germany.
Yeah, unfortunately.
Agreed. Mm. Why don't you tell everybody how you got into wine, what your background is, and things of that nature?
Yeah, you know, I come from an area like here in New York, no wine at all. I mean, I come from the middle of Germany, and I had the opportunity
to work. The name of that?
It's called Westphalia, it's called Gütersloh. You know, it's a very small town. You don't need to know, really, but it's right in the middle of nowhere. I mean, if you want to see the butt of the world...
How many kids in your 8th grade class? How many kids were in your class?
What do you mean, how many kids?
In when you were in school.
Oh, it was like 25, 30.
Smart. Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
And so I went to work in the Napa Valley, and this is how I
got... How old were you?
I was like 22, 24.
And what made you jump into Napa?
Well, my uncle, he helped me find a job at the Auberge du Soleil. I was trained as a chef. That's my background.
I knew that.
You know, I was cooking, sizzling. But I always had a fancy for wine. And so it's very difficult in Europe to get into the wine business. You know, everybody's like, hey, what do you want to do? You need to drink at least a house worth of wine before you know anything about wine. And
sure.
I said, no, come on. This can't be it. So I moved to the Napa Valley, and then I had good luck to meet, hook up with all the winemakers, could drink all the good wines, good stuff. And when I returned, I went to sommelier school. And that's in Heidelberg, so I went for a year, and that wasn't really to my satisfaction, so I went on to the Master Sommelier program. You know, and I got beaten up many times, because English is a tough language once it comes to wine, and once you want to speak it really, you know, clearly, and so it took me a couple of years, and in 1999 I finished it. And I started in 1995 my career as a professional sommelier, so that worked very well.
Where did you work when you first got into the sommelier world?
I worked in Leipzig. It's in the eastern part of Germany, and I worked in a big hotel corporation, Interconti, and we had an Austrian hotel director. He always wanted to have a sommelier, so this was really my first, possibility to sneak into the wine scene.
Sure, because he wanted one. You were there.
Yes.
You raised your hand.
Yes.
He high-fived you.
Yes, and I said, please give me some money, too.
He gave you a little bit of money.
Yeah.
But he gave you an opportunity to get into the industry.
Yes, yes.
Had you ever worked as a somm outside of Germany?
Not really, no.
So
most of the time in Germany.
So for the last decade plus, you've been a sommelier in Germany.
Yes.
And in 99, you became a master sommelier.
Master sommelier, yes.
And you became were you the first German?
No, actually I was the second.
So you're number two of two.
I'm number two of number two. Of number one.
And where do you currently...
Currently, I still live in Hamburg, and I started, you know, about writing about wine, taking trips for people to go abroad, tasting wine, and I have a television show which is coming up soon, so that's going to be maybe in March. That's going to be MasterChef. It's a program where people compete about cooking, but they needed someone, a person who is capable of both. Drinking wine and eating well.
So you're hosting it, or you're competing in it?
Oh, I'm hosting it. Well, we have 120 candidates, and they have to.
So you would say maybe you are like the Ryan Seacrest of Germany.
Seacrest?
Yes.
What is that, a Seacrest?
Don't worry, you just made a lot of people very happy. Okay, and so tell me about a little bit more about your experience in California. Who did you really strike a chord with? Did anybody stand out? Any wineries? Any experiences, anything that would, you know, there's a lot of people who watch this show who have ambitions to get into the wine industry. I get pounded with emails of that. You know, you obviously had an uncle. Was he connected to the wine scene in California?
Well, he's a chef too, but he knew a lot of people. So, you know, once I was working in the Napa Valley, I called the people up. I said, hey, can I come? I would like to know something about wine. And some people were really nasty to me, you know.
Really?
It's like, what do you want? No, we don't have any wine for you.
In California?
Yes, but many people were very friendly. And this is really the difference. I mean, I'd say in Europe, the people are more reserved. And in California, at that time, they were very open. So they say, okay, come over, taste. But I had some people, I remember, at one winery, I was taking notes, and he said, people are taking notes, are not very welcome here. I said, oh, But
so you even felt snobbery within, even in the late 90s in California, there was some
snobbery. No, it was early 90s. It was the early 90s even. So
how could there be snobbery in California in the early 90s? That blows my mind.
No, but they were, in general, they were very, very nice.
Right. So
there was just a couple
of experience. You would say 93%?
Yes, at least.
95?
95. I go there.
How about 6?
No, give me 95. 95. No, okay, no, no. I'd only give you 95.
Fine. Now, I did a show on German Pinot Noirs not too long ago on the Thunder Show, and I think that I'm very passionate about getting people to understand there is red wine in Germany. Mm-hmm. Is that something that you give a crap about, or you really don't give a rat's ass about that?
No. Pinot Noir now is becoming more and more popular, mm-hmm. though I think it's a finicky grape, and a lot of people don't understand really its real qualities. Mm-hmm. You know, color is light, flavors are more fragile, and a lot of people are like, hey, this is a glass of wine, this is big, this is... Okay, I understand it. Pinot Noir is different, you know?
Sure.
It's coming always around the block. It is, absolutely.
And gets a little earthy.
And I think German Pinot Noir in particular, we have a great climate for growing
Pinot
Noir.
I think you do too.
Because it's cold, you get the crispiness, you get the freshness. Bah, it's a cutting wine.
I think you do too. Now tell me about the consumer in Germany, because now I'm fat. Excuse me for a sec. Tell me about the German consumer. Let's talk about 18 to 20 to 30. Is there more in, you know, you kind of lived it. I've always been, I'm very excited about my position in the wine world in America, because when I was 18, 17 and really getting into wine, it was the culture of people in my age group getting into wine was so rare. Mm-hmm. And now, even though I'm still in my early 30s, watching 21-year-olds, 22-year-olds watch the show, come to the store, ask for serious wines or not so serious wines, just the interest level is so much greater. Mm-hmm. You had a very similar situation. You're a young guy. Mm-hmm. You've been into wine now long enough that it, you know, longer. So have you seen a big shift in the German wine consumer?
Yeah.
Has the interest grown?
Yes, and first of all, I mean, I think the variety has grown. I mean, when I started, it was Bordeaux, and then it was Burgundy, maybe, and that was the only wines that were allowed.
And then the German
Of course, the German Rieslings, you know, things like this, but that was it. And now you have wines from Portugal, which find a high acceptance. Mm-hmm. You have wines from Spain. New World wines have a great acceptance.
How about American wines?
That's a little bit tricky at the moment. I tell you what, because the pricing policy, I think they're quite high.
Yep.
And
so they become overpriced for what they are.
A lot of people don't really know about American wines. I mean, just being now to the Napa Valley and to Central Coast, and I visited some areas.
You took German consumers to these areas?
I will next year. I'm considering next year. And there is such a variety of wines now coming. Sangiovese, Nebbiolo, and I've tasted some great stuff from California.
Mm-hmm.
But for the German people, I think, or for most Europeans, California wine is about Chardonnay and is about Cabernet. Maybe Zinfandel.
Yeah.
Maybe Pinot, but that's it.
Yeah. And how about the hometown love? I mean, do people still predominantly want to drink German wines? I mean, is Riesling just flowing down people's throats like it's free?
Yeah, Germany is picking really up on its own wine culture. Finally. It took really some years.
Right, because there was a snobby factor within Germany about their own wines.
Exactly. Yeah.
Wild.
And now Trocken wines, which are not so fancy
dry
here, but the dry wines are becoming more and more popular.
Whereas before they would drink Alsatian wines?
Alsatian has really dropped because
Trocken's picked up, right?
Yes, and German wines have.
Mm-hmm. Well, that makes sense,
arisen,
right?
Yeah,
that would be the alternative. Well, let's get into the first wine. You went downstairs and picked some wines.
Yes.
Tell us why you picked this wine, probably because it's a little older.
Oh, I like it. You know, some wines.
Are you familiar with Silicon?
Silicon, I know him. He's a very cool cat, I have to say. He's one of the
most modest
winemakers I have ever seen. He's so modest. He's always very outspoken, clear about what he's saying. He doesn't make a big fuss about his wines.
And this is a Riesling Spätlese from 1992,
yes.
Single vineyard. Are you familiar with the vineyard?
Yeah, Saarburger Rausch is one of the best vineyards.
See how
in
I let
Lausanne.
Him say the Saarburger Rausch, because I don't want to get pissed on. It's just some little skills.
And you know, Rausch means basically when you drink too much, you get a Rausch.
Right.
You know? So I always say, like, if you have a Saarburger Rausch, then you have a good one. You can get on this one. You know?
And this is a 92 vintage,
92.
Imported by Rudy Wies, who I'm sure you're probably familiar with as well. So I'm sure the reason you picked that is you don't get to see, really, even in the American market, probably not even in the German market, a lot of older Rieslings on store shelves.
No.
They're in collections, they're at restaurants.
You see, the Germans are so furious about their wines, but what they have, they always want to have the new wines, which is, I think, absolutely bullshit, really.
Sure.
I mean, a good Riesling needs at least 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 years. And
92 it adds so much character in
it
those
does.
4 or 5 years.
And you get,
right?
I mean, you go, I mean, when they're young, they're all fruity. They
it's
have
like a baby, right? I mean, like a baby, as Eric was telling me about Danny, the first 6 months, you know, it's the seventh month is when it gets really going.
Yeah, and here you get all the characteristics now. You get this spiciness.
Did you already give it a sniffy sniff?
I had a sniffy sniff, a small one.
Yes, okay, let's give it one, officially.
Mm. You know what it reminds me of? Like creamy vanilla pear,
A creamsicle, right? Creamsicle? Because that's what I get, a creamsicle. Like the orange, it has like an orange meat and then there's creamy inside. I get a lot of creamsicle action in here as well. Mm. And it's got a little petrol. It's peachy. It's very peachy.
Mm. But the freshness, wonderful. Mm. I really like this one. It's not really...
Now, are you being hometown German?
Of course, I have to be.
Okay, okay. Just let me, because you're going to send this link to friends in Germany, and if you said this is piss water, they'd probably punch you in the mouth, right?
Oh, well, maybe something else. You
I
know,
understand.
So.
Well, you got to get serious.
Experience
I understand.
So we want to be...
No, but, I mean, this is... I'll be honest with you. I'm taking a little bit of back. I mean, let's break this down with all seriousness. This has a very peachy component, almost like a blini, right? Like, really...
Cooked. Cooked apple too, I think.
I think so as well. Like maybe like hot apple sauce. Mm. You like hot apple sauce?
Hot apple sauce, yeah. I've had it here in the United States. It's a super.
Let's give it a whirl.
Mm.
So on the palate, it is almost completely driven by apples to me.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like baked apple meets Granny Smith apple. Because the tannins on the back, almost a little tinny. Like... I get a metallic component on the back end of my palate.
It does have a lot of, let's say, Meyer lime, which we don't get in Europe, but they have it in California.
Uh-huh.
It's, let's say, a kind of a fruity lime. Oh, and I think it's great. It's just pure. It's so... I mean, if you think of a 92...
Nobody would believe this,
no,
right?
This is young.
They would all
this
think... If the somewhat educated wine consumer stumbled upon this in their basement... Or in their, even in their wine room, they'd be like, oh, damn it. Why did this slide by? I missed it.
Mm.
This is too old. Mm. And that's a humongous misconception amongst Rieslings who I find a lot of Rieslings outlasting their Cabernet counterparts.
Mm.
I've had a lot of, I mean, let's talk about 73 and 76. I mean, these are incredible vintage Rieslings that are...
Now, 76 was a very hot vintage.
Very
I'm not sure about 73, though.
73, I went to a 73 tasting not too long ago at Danube a couple years ago, and it was... one of the best white wine experiences I've ever had.
But, you know, it brings out really the mineral aspects of the Tsar. I think this is a great wine. And last night we had dinner at a Chinese place with some colleagues, and we had a 2002 from the Tsar, from a different producer.
Mm-hmm.
It was a stunning wine. I mean, everybody liked it. I mean, it's like sometimes it's very difficult for people to say, hey, I really like this. I do really like this. A lot of people say, oh, look at the label. Oh, it's German. Look, I can't understand it anyway. No, it's bullshit.
That's a big problem in the U.S.
Mm-hmm. And In Germany, too. Ignorance is a big problem of the wine business, isn't
no
it?
No question. At the end of the day, I'm a big fan of this wine as well. I think it's got tremendous characteristics. It may be at a point where maybe, you know, I would say probably another 2-3 years and then it's going to start getting a little tired.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, this is probably a prime time, maybe last year, but it's a good time to really drink this wine. Goes with a slew of different foods, in my opinion. You know, speaking of the classic Chinese Thai, that's so much fun. I mean, there's nothing more fun for wine nerds like us to get together in a simplistic Chinese restaurant and drink a lot of Riesling.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's such a thing, isn't
and
it?
And you can drink 7.5%.
Last night, did you drink a bunch of... Right, so you can drink a lot
of...
Yeah,
you can more.
Did you last night get together with other master sommeliers?
Yes, I went to
It's a very tight-knit community, right?
Here in New York, anyway.
Very much. Why don't you tell them a little bit? I think you guys will get a kick out of this. This is a very, exclusive club, but a very tight-knit club, right?
Yes.
I mean, almost like you guys consider yourself like Jedi. Like, from Star Wars, right?
Well, some people might. I mean, what is really nice about it is you can get connected with a lot of people, let's say internationally. We have now someone in New Zealand. We have now some people in Germany.
So when you travel, it's easy to call them up and say, hey,
and
there's that mutual respect.
Mm-hmm.
So who were you with last night?
So I was with Fred Dexheimer.
Friend of mine.
He's a cool man.
He
looks a little bit like me. Someone
he does look you guys do have some similarities.
Well, he has a beard. That's the only problem.
Yes, well, you can work on that. Or you can shave.
No, but I think master sommeliers are connected. And, you know, there's a certain kind of respect you pay to the other one if he has passed the test.
This
is a great guy. He has done it. I mean, it's tough.
Yeah. Well, to me, on my palate, this wine rules in right in that 90-point range. I'm a big fan of this wine. I think it's very, for a $35 price point, a essential price point to pay to expand your palate. A very inexpensive way to learn about a lot about wine.
Yeah,
you know, pay $35 to drink a wine of this age and this varietal is an eye-opening experience, I think, for the majority of people that are watching this video. And to me, that's where you really look at prices. You know, there's probably better $35 wine out there, but definitely not a $35 wine that's going to teach you as much as tasting this wine. And I think that is immensely imperative.
Mm. And you know what? It is a very honest wine at the same time.
I like that.
Because
I
it has everything. It has everything. It has minerality. It has the so-called terroir. And it has fruit.
Let's take a little bit of a turn here. Ooh. I thought this would be a little bit of fun for us. This is a Gewürztraminer from Chile.
Gewürztraminer in Chile?
Well, yeah, exactly. I figured you'd enjoy this. This is the Cartagena. This comes from a very small producer that I'm a big fan of called Casa Marin. This wine rolls in at $16. And what's really neat about this is Jay Miller, the wine critic, scored us 91 points, who's from writing for Robert Parker. In this part of the world, it's a little rinse. So a very highly scored Gewürztraminer from, of all places, Chile. And you're a master sommelier. Mm-hmm. I've been in the industry my whole life. How many times have you had a Gewürztraminer from Chile in your entire career?
It's...
Watch this.
Maybe the first time, I'd say. I've been to San
and
Antonio.
I've had two.
I've been to San Antonio Valley.
Yeah.
That's a cool place. I mean, that's
awesome place.
You can see the ocean from there.
Gorgeous, isn't it?
Great.
Think about what just happened. A lot of years of experience here. First one, third one, ever. So this is expanding palates. I mean, this is a very, a varietal that has not been known for this part of the world. So kudos to Casa Marin for trying it. Now listen, we may taste it and hate it and say, we'll never drink another Gewürztraminer from Chile. Mm. But I hope we wouldn't do that because one should not be the way you totally qualify.
Well, climate is cool. I think it should work there. Why not?
It can.
But Gewürztraminer also is a very finicky grape variety.
I mean, and if you don't treat it right and you try to, you know, I'm dying to try this wine. It's been on my radar. I had a great customer that comes in here who's a huge Gewürz fan. I told him to try a bottle. He came back, wasn't super fond of it, but I don't trust his palate. I only trust mine. And I've been wanting to get it on the show. And when I saw that you were coming the other day, I was like, oh, you know what? That would be perfect. You know, Gewürztraminer has lost a little cachet in Germany a little bit, right?
Yeah.
I mean, I've seen a lot less offered to me. I mean, when I first got involved a decade or so ago buying, there was, I would say it was 60-40 when I would see a list, right? 60% would be Riesling, 40 would be Gewürz. It's much more 80-20. And with 80-15 with 5% now Pinot, you know?
Riesling is number one, that's for sure.
And has it been? And there's been even a bigger growth of Riesling over Gewürz.
And Gewürz is more popular now in Italy, I found out.
Yeah,
Italians
absolutely.
Italians go nuts for this grape.
And is that because the Trocken Rieslings have become more popular in Germany, that the Gewürz has fallen off a little
yes,
bit?
Yes, and they are, you know, they have kind of, the French always say it's a little
Trocken
bit...
Trocken and dry.
Pü, pü. Mm-hmm. The French say pü, yeah. So it's a little bit, well, yeah, you know, it's a nasty word, but... and I like Gewürztraminer, you know,
I'm
you have to admit that you are, let's say, yet that you like fruit. You like, it's, let's
I would
say,
never
exaggerated
poo-poo
style.
At fruit. Let's give it a sniffy sniff. High in sugar on the nose.
It does have sugar a lot cane. Of floral flavors too.
Tons. I mean, this is an absolute florist. I mean, this is like going to the floral convention at the Raritan Center here in Edison, New Jersey.
And then you pick up a lot of spice and raisin.
Raisin. Like, you mean like almost like a white raisin, right? Mm-hmm. Like a, yeah, mm-hmm. Interesting. I get a lot of spice, a lot.
Mm.
Ginger. I get a lot of ginger on the nose.
Yeah, okay, I get that.
Dry.
Mm. Big style.
Big style.
Wow.
Is the alcohol in the back end bothering you a little bit?
Well, there is a little bit... Well, the only thing, there is a kind of a bitterness I'm tasting.
Feels
but
a little off-balance, right?
Yeah, I wouldn't have it as an aperitif, but I think it would be very good with food. It needs really food. I mean, it's not like a Gewürztraminer you can have to start with. Like,
right.
You know, that's a very common thing now.
Sure.
Start off with a Gewürztraminer.
That's right.
I go more for, let's say, really spicy food to get away with this bitterness, but it's a wonderful wine. Beauty.
I find it a little off-balance, though. I really do. I feel like...
The alcohol.
The alcohol is beating it up.
But
I'm very sensitive to that, though.
Mm-hmm.
And there are a lot of Gewürz. Yeah, I mean, I respect what it is, but I gotta tell you.
How much does it mean?
Yeah, I'm 13.9, which means it's 14.5.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah, probably, yeah.
Yeah.
Most likely.
It feels a little hot for me on the back end. I think, now, we are tasting at room temperature. So if more chilled, that will subside.
I think so.
It's an interesting wine. You know, the funny thing is, when I tasted it, the first thing that came to my mind was Langoustines. You know, I like those little suckers. And, I would pair it with that. To me, this is a wine that really drinks between now and maybe the next 3 years. You don't want to go too long with it. You think it'll last longer?
No. Well, if it does, but it gets even bigger, heavier.
Yeah,
I think you should
droopy,
drink it
right?
young.
Yeah.
But what about curry? I think curry dishes would be great. Some Indian stuff with it, I think that could be great.
I think you're right. I think you're right. Gewürz and spice have always... I mean, every time I think of Gewürz, I think of Indian and Thai food. I just do. Every time. Like, right out the bat. I just find this a little bit gloppy for me, a little off balance. The heat's a little bit too much for me. And I'll be honest with you, I feel like it's acting too... You know what it acts like to me? You know when you see like a 9-year-old girl dressed inappropriately and you're like, what are the parents thinking? You know, like it's trying to be more than it is yet. Lipstick, maybe kind of something crazy. Mm-hmm. I don't want to get too, you know, I don't want to go to jail. But you know, to me, this is like a teenager trying to act like a grown-up but doesn't have that sense of maturity yet.
So it's a pretender?
A little bit. More like being a little bit too ambitious. I feel like they're trying to do too much with this grape, and it's acting bigger than it needs to, and that if they treat it a little different, it's almost like the winemaker decided to treat this like a different varietal. Like the way he would have handled, or she would have handled, not sure who the winemaker, Maria.
Yeah,
Maria. Like she would have handled, I feel like she would have handled, maybe even Chardonnay, she ended up handling this, and it got too big for its own bridges.
Yeah, maybe, but that's a very young district as well. Maybe they have to learn a little bit more how to pick it. And Gewürztraminer, you know,
it's a very young.
It's not hard. It's hard to grow as well.
And it takes time for people to, you know,
understand.
No doubt. And I think what's, you know, I give them massive kudos for trying to do the varietal. And you're right. You maybe look back at this in 3 or 4 years when they've kind of figured out the land a little bit more. They're going to make a more balanced effort. I think Jay Miller's a little high with 91 points.
But still, I mean, if you have a great dinner and this is on your dinner table, I mean, come on, you wouldn't refuse it. It's great.
You know what's very funny about me? I'll be honest. Mm. Even wines that I score in my own mind a 60, right? Mm. I actually enjoy. Mm. I'm so into the experience of wine that it's really not about how good it is at some level, which is very weird. Mm. Do you know what I mean? I mean, we taste a lot of wine. It's like, it's almost like uniqueness. You said something perfect before. Truth, right? Mm-hmm. You know, to me, the truth is more exciting than it, whether I like it or not. Mm-hmm. A lot of wines try to masquerade, and I think when they really allow the terroir and the sense of place and the varietal and the land talk, it's unique, instead of masking a style that a lot of people may like.
Yeah, but I mean, this is very common and very easy to mask, and a lot of people are into this, and I think if people are trying, if they're really working hard on it, like these people here, and this is an also, I think a good example that Gewürztraminer probably can go in Chile. Maybe they haven't found the...
Sure, the right balance.
The right balance, but they can. Oh, that's a cool stuff.
I know Gotta Give Best has the score. To me, 87 plus, solid stuff. I think you're a little higher.
I go to 88 plus. I give it
full point, right. it's a very interesting wine. It's definitely, again, right back to the last thing I said about the last wine. I believe at $16, it is worth the price of admission. I'm sure for you, passionate about wine, you're now, are you like this? I'm like this. You're kind of happy now you've had a Chilean Gewürztraminer, right? It's like it's like a notch on the belt, right?
Exactly, and it helped me a little bit to understand, grown up a little bit more.
And that's the whole game. Let's rinse here, and let's see what's going on with this. Tell me why you picked this. This is a Becker Pinot Noir, $17. This is grown in the Southern Pfalz region?
Yeah, exactly.
Slightly north of Alsace, right?
You know, in the Southern Pfalz, it's really interesting. These people are very ambitious. I say in the Northern Pfalz, this is where all the great vineyards are. But in the Southern Pfalz, you find, let's say, I think the more innovative people, such as Becker.
They have less to lose, right? They've got more to. They've got less tradition, less brand, so they're able to explore a little.
And they're fighting really hard. And of course, like
a lot of passion.
I think so. And especially Mr. Becker.
You know him?
Yes, I've met him.
He's a nice chap?
Yes. His son also is a very nice chap. And they have a winemaker. He helps them out. He works in South Africa. I just forget his name now. But he helps. Yeah, so they have some advice on Pinot Noir. Mm-hmm. And I think that helps a lot to understand more the grape variety. So you don't make a German Pinot Noir. Because German Pinot Noir in the 70s and the 80s, that was like...
Yeah, I mean, it really killed the brand.
It did.
It's just now that they're recouping from those 15 years of... The Dark Ages, you know?
So the Dark Ages.
You like that, huh?
That's cool.
So you can see your fingers through it, so it's real Pinot Noir, not like all this over Syrah blend Pinot that we're seeing in so many places of the world now. Let's give it a sniffy sniff.
Hey, the color's nice. I mean,
I love the color. It's a little cloudy,
it's
right?
Like, yeah, but I love unfiltered that. Probably.
Yeah, of course. Tight nose. I'm not getting so many things here, you know?
It doesn't really jump out of the nose, does it?
No, it's just, it's classic, right? You get a little bit of like, you know.
It's more the raspberry, sour cherry flavors, which I get here. And it's more fine, subdued.
Yeah, you're not getting a lot of the stinky, stink, stink action here. You're really just getting kind of like red fruit. I was going to even say a little hint of strawberry. But I get the raspberries probably as the dominant grape.
It's not as earthy as a real Pinot Noir, let's say, from the Pinot Noir Holy Grail in Burgundy. But come on, this is German Pinot Noir. This is
no, but you know what? It's pretty interesting from the scent. It's extremely mineral driven. There's great minerality here, which I like. But it's a little hollow in the mid palate. I'm a little bit worried about the transition flavor to the finish. It seemed to kind of clip off.
Well, I mean, what do you expect at $17? I mean, come on. That's I mean, it's a very honest, good, clean wine, and it's
be careful.
Very,
well, I expect a whole lot. Well, $17 is money.
It is, absolutely.
Now, I know I what you're agree. Saying. But Pinot, you know, Noir,
on,
yeah.
Pinot Noir, $60,
I'm not comparing
70s.
It to $200 Pinot from Burgundy. But you're not wrong. I mean, it's really getting hard to find good Pinot under $20.
Yeah,
I mean,
exactly.
It's a real challenge. Mm-hmm. It's a huge challenge.
It is a challenge at all.
I'm actually frightened by the challenge of it. But at the same token, there's a... Listen, if you're drinking Pinot for the sake of drinking Pinot, fine. But boy, I can buy a $17 Dolcetto that's going to rip this wine's face off for me. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And to me, that's where it gets a little bit... You know, I'm just not married to a varietal or a region.
If
you know,
you're comparing that way, of course. I
you know what I mean?
Yeah.
I understand right. what you're saying for Pinot, but this is...
But in its category,
I understand. What else do you think about this wine?
What I like about it is it's not pretentious in the oak job. So the oak is not too overwhelming. I might,
for sure.
I think maybe it's been in a big oak cask or in old...
Yeah.
Old small.
Yep.
Yeah.
I like, there's a little
second
bit of...
Second third use, something like
yeah,
this.
Yeah, there's a little bit of like a smoky bacon component on the nose too that's starting to come out, which I like as I continue to drink it.
And I'd rather drink it a little cooler than we are drinking it at the moment. I'd like to
talk to me about
it.
That a little bit.
I think Pinot Noir is misjudged in many ways, that especially about temperature. Wine on a glance is misjudged by drinking it on the wrong temperature.
Are you a big temperature guy?
Well, I say like I'm not like you know the guy who sticks in the temperature. What do you say? Thermometer.
Sure.
Thermostat in the glass and looks how. But I like it when they start cool. And then they warm up. And this is like, wow, now they develop. Now is something here. This is singing. You know, I'd like to be surprised by a wine. And I think when I start a little cooler with this wine, which is obviously a little lighter, then I think you will have more of these fruity flavors. And if you have some, think of a salami, you know, some really good cold cuts, really, you know, juicy, beefy, spicy, this would be perfect. I mean, I don't expect this wine to be on the Christmas
Let me ask you a question. When you bought for your restaurants, would you always want the wine to be at room temperature?
Room temperature? Well, to me, we serve the wines at 16 to 17 degrees.
No, not when you served them, but when you bought, when you evaluated a wine, did you prefer the salespeople to bring it to you at room temperature or chilled, or how did you actually evaluate when you bought?
Oh, when I bought? Well, no, when they're a little warmer, it's better.
Sure. And so here's like the great debate, right? Because a lot of people, a lot of Master Psalms, we've had a lot of people on the show. It's been a classic theme where we've talked about this. I am a massive, massive proponent of all wine at room temperature, all. Which puts me in, as you know, the very fine minority. However, I find it massively interesting that most people that debate about having it at right temperature are buyers, have been buyers in their career, and all of them have tasted it at room temperature. Why? Because you actually get to taste more of the flaws and you get to see more of the truth of the wine.
Exactly.
So to me, what makes us more special than the consumer is how I always thought. If we're looking for the truth and the flaws, well, why shouldn't the consumer see it in it all of its mighty? And it's a very interesting debate that, listen, I get it. Let's the consumer taste it at its best way, right? Or what people think is the best way. It's been a very fascinating thing for me. Listen, I'm in the far minority, and people much brighter like yourself and everybody else have said, you know, root temperatures, temperatures, temperatures. I just find it fascinating that all the people, 99% of the people that say temperature, 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 when they bought, wanted a room, right? Because you know the great trick, right? You have a Pinot Grigio that's bought, get as cold as that's right.
You can even detect, let's say, if you have a corky wine or something,
that's
just
right.
Chill it out. A lot of people don't know it then. Yeah.
That's right. And
no,
so
there's
to
ways
me,
to cheat.
Interesting, right?
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Become a room temperature guy. All right.
Okay, I try. You know, when I come home, I will try.
You'll change
but
the game.
You're honest. I mean, that's a cool statement you're making.
Well, thank you.
I think about
it. I appreciate
it.
Yes. All right. Yes. Now we're getting to something very special. Are you? Have you been a hip fan of?
Yes, I like him.
Is he a controversial character in Germany?
I wouldn't say he's not controversial at all. He's
okay.
He's
such a bomb. I mean, the wines are so bomb. They're so amazing. I was wondering if in Germany they were viewed as maybe too over the top or anything like that.
I think these wines, they are so hard to come by now in Germany. You want to buy a wine of him? It's like almost you have to put
Let's
yourself
Let's talk
on
about
the
what we're talking about. This is the Dunhoff Riesling Auschlese 2006 from the single vit, right?
Oberhäuserbrücke. Hey, you are getting there.
I've been working on it. Oberhäuserbrücke. So
it's a bridge. Brücke means bridge.
Yes.
Oberhausen, so it's a part of the, let's say, the district.
This is a uncanny, sorry, Matt, an uncanny dessert wine that has caught massive acclaim here in the U.S. It was scored 98 points by David Schoenbeck, who is now doing the writing for Robert Parker's Wine Advocate in this part of the world.
That's close to perfection.
I mean, it's a big, big score. Dessert wines tend to go a little high, as you know. 45 bones for a, you know, when you start comparing that rating price ratio to the Chem, to some of the Hungarian Tokais that Mod over here on the other side of the camera gets addicted to. Uh-huh. It's a little bit of like a crackhead.
Why are you into Tokai?
He loves the sugar.
Oh, you like the
Eric
stuff,
likes
really,
Tokai
right?
too.
Eric too.
Do you know Eric is the original cameraman of Wine Library TV for the first 100, how many episodes, guys?
120.
120? Well, damn, you've done a lot of them. Forget about that, Eric.
Hey, nice to meet you, Eric. That's cool.
Okay, so 45 bones, Auschlese. This is going to be a sweet wine. How are the Auschlese dessert wines doing in Germany?
You know, these wines are really having a hard time back home, I think.
Too expensive?
They are expensive. I mean, there is a certain clientele for it, but I mean, you cannot make money on these wines, really. I mean, a lot of the vintners just take the effort to produce something like this because this is like state of the art. This is like their message. This is like they say, hey.
On the world scale, right?
Exactly.
Screw off the Chem. This is us.
But the money you make with the Trocken wines or Cabernet
or
wines,
ice wines.
Or, you know, a little lower. But Auschlese sometimes, in this case, probably this is not even an Auslese. This is probably a Bärenauslese, and he degraded it. I'm almost positive.
Yeah, I'm sure you're right.
Always modest about these wines.
Let's give it a snippy sniff.
Well, it has a wonderful
great color, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Like fresh cut star fruit on the nose. You like that, Eric?
Oh.
I made it a point to. Yeah, I've been dying to use this star fruit. It finally came through. No,
doesn't
I like.
Smell like anything. Like star fruit.
You know what's so funny?
When you
I went to.
Carambol?
Yeah. In like December, I went to Whole Foods in New York. I saw star fruit. They just got it in. I was like talking to somebody. But he's like, "This is the best star fruit." And I was like, "I was like, you know, I like bought it just to smell it." And I'm like, "Star fruit doesn't smell like much, but yeah, I get a distinction. It's almost like it smells a little bit like Sprite. A little lemon lime action here on the nose as well for me."
Well, it does have some green flavors. To me, like basil?
Basil?
Basil, tarragon,
really?
Kind of. Come on.
I'm trying.
Give it a try.
I'm trying.
But there's...
It really has... You know, it smells a little bit like Vicks Vapor... right? Like it smells a little like Ricola. You know that?
Ricola!
Right?
Wer hat's erfunden? Yes. Who invented it?
I have no idea.
Well, it's the Swiss who invented it.
Okay.
So it's not the Germans.
I didn't say it was... Listen, is starfruit German? But it does have an a very heavy herbaceousness I feel, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
I honestly feel like I just got a cold and I bought new cough drops at the store. Do you have a cold?
Well,
Lizzie's going to kill my wife. My wife doesn't want me being,
nasal breakdown. This is what
that's
I call it. Yeah.
Right, you told me. I just thought this was stylish.
Well, I got it from England. It's a school scarf, but you know, it helps.
Well, it's nice. Oh, by the way, for somebody who was asking, it is a Cartier watch. Matt, this was a big debate yesterday in the comments. I don't know if you saw it. It's nice.
A Cartier or Cartier? No, Cartier. Oh, Cartier. Wow.
A Carto. All right.
Come on, but this...
Is it soapy to you?
No, it's not soapy at all. For me, this is like...
It's soapy.
This is pure heaven. No, it's not soapy.
It's not heaven. It's soapy.
What is soapy? What do you mean? What kind of soap you mean?
Go in the bathroom, wash your hands, there's soap, smell them. It's got a little hint of soapy.
Well, probably you used the wrong soap.
Maybe. I like that.
Sorry.
All right, let's give it a whirl. I'm not gonna spit. It's so good.
Are you spitting?
No.
I'm not spitting at all.
Right?
This is cool.
You know what I love about this? It's not goopy. Right? So many dessert wines are too viscous.
Cloying.
Way too cloying. This is much more fresh on the palate.
Does the acidity balance it?
I think this is massive balance of acid and fruit. Do you get pineapple, a little pineapple flavor?
Yeah, it's all the tropicals, you know?
Yeah.
It's like almost like having a vacation in the Caribbean.
I love that. I usually say that, actually. It's like I put my mouth in Hawaii.
Yeah, it is.
This is very good. Now I'm starting to smell a little bit more honey. Are you getting a little more honey, like a little honey component on the nose?
Well, I think honey you can always say when you have a German dessert wine.
Yeah, probably, right?
You have always honey. I mean, if you don't know anything about wine, just say, oh, it smells like apple and honey, you know?
Tell them. Damn, in the camera.
Okay.
Right here.
Well, and if it's a red wine, just say cherry. You're probably always be right, okay? Cherry. And if you're running, you're really sophisticated, just say, oh, it's mineral. The other one has to prove what is mineral.
That's
I mean,
right.
What is mineral?
Because it's like arm wrestling.
Oh, this is wonderful.
I like this
Come
a lot.
On. This has length.
This has length.
But in your palate, you wouldn't score as 98 points. This is nice, but you wouldn't go...
A 95?
Yeah, I mean, I agree. To me, this is a 94, 95 point type. I'd probably go 94, actually. I'm a little bit, you know, tougher.
You know, there's it's a difficulty, I think, judging always one of these points.
I mean, it helps, here's what the end of the day...
Hey, come on.
Absolutely.
You have to drink it.
This is extremely... I totally agree. We have this debate all the time. Every time I want to jump off rate, I want to come up with my own rating scale, like with animals. Like, oh, this is an elephant. And that might mean it's... I don't know, I'm just kidding. This is extremely well made.
I think so.
Very good German wine. Very good dessert wine on a global scale. And once again, if you're like me, which I fully believe that the majority... of Sauternes, Tokaj, Trocken, you know, Bernauschlese, ice wines, the majority are too cloying and too viscous and too syrupy. I can go to IHOP and drink out of one of those dirty, topping things. This is a treat because this has immense balance. This is where David probably fell in love with this wine. It has immense balance, in my opinion. What would you eat with this?
You know what? A lot of people always have dessert wines. Dessert wines have to be drunk with dessert.
Crazy.
It's a dessert by itself. I mean, if you want, you can have, let's say, a pineapple caramelized, coconut ice cream. You know, I'd go for the tropical section.
Because you taste the tropical big time in here, right?
Still.
I feel like a little pina colada residence, right?
It's super. And it's also, you can have it as an aperitif. I mean, you don't have to have a lot of it. And you can keep the bottle probably in the refrigerator for 2 or 3 weeks. And
you feel that long?
Well, let's say 2 weeks.
Yeah.
But still a couple of time. But come on, you know, you don't need to drink $45 like in 10
minutes.
Now,
what if you have a lady friend over? You might want to.
That will help.
You could drink the whole darn thing. Or better yet, her. She can drink the whole darn thing. You've used that move. Admit it here right now to the maniac. I've seen it in
your
face. You've used dessert wine move on some ladies.
They're called Schlüpferstürmer. You know, it's basically...
I like that.
Well, Schlüpfer is like the knickers, you know. And
knickers,
Stürmer
okay.
is, you know, take the knickers by storm.
I see. So you've used...
oh, this is getting embarrassing.
No, don't
are
be
we,
embarrassed.
Are we still taping?
We added here. We added
okay,
here.
Cool.
Okay, so, great stuff. Yeah, I think 94 points sums that up.
Give it 95, come on. Well, you're really tough.
94 plus.
Okay.
Because I like you a lot.
All right. Okay.
I want you to be my new co-host. You need to come from Germany here once a month.
I'd like to.
Done.
You pay the ticket?
Matt will.
Okay.
All right, so, question of the day. You get to ask the maniacs any question you want. It doesn't have to be about wine, but when we have a guest, it's a tradition that you get to ask them a question. They'll leave comments. You get to enjoy it. Leave it there. Let's also link up your email here so people can send you emails because we have a lot of German viewers, a lot of European viewers, and they'll probably want to come and say hi and check you out. So, Matt, make sure we link that up. We'll get his email. And fire away. Question of the day.
Okay, question of the day. Can you make a great wine below €5 or say $8? Is it possible? I'd like to know. We had a big debate about this in Germany. You know, I said below $5 is really difficult. It is.
Don't tell them what you. This way.
This is my question.
So,
are you able to make it?
Is it possible to make a very good wine for under $8?
Yeah.
Is what you're asking.
Yes.
One of my favorite questions we've had so far. You, with a little bit of let's link it up. One of the best videos ever made by a fan in the history of Wine Library TV. Mott, please link that up. As soon as you're done, scroll down, watch this little shindig.
Tack it on the end of this episode.
You'll tack it on?
Yeah.
You're amazing, Mott.
Wow.
Mott will
wow.
tack it on to the end of this. So in a second, sit back, enjoy, answer the question today. I want 300-400 comments for this guy. This guy's awesome. Also email him, say hello. You, with a little bit of me, we are changing the wine world. Don't worry, rumor has it. With a little bit of me, nice. Internet's most passionate on, it was perfect. I'm gonna break this camera one day. With a little bit of me, we're changing. Here is my answer, my friend, of the Vayner Nation, what I wanna do, which is this. That was good work. I brought my Jets football. With a little bit of me, nice. 7 to 9 p.m. Oh, baby! Lizzie is going to kill me! Yeah, it's too much of an ad. I can't get to it. Really excited. We have another special surprise coming for you guys, because we just want to keep giving you presents on the 91 points mod and give it a pass with multiple Z's. Everybody, come out of the woodworks. We're changing, remember? That I'd like to see new wristbands on the way with a little bit of me. Need that. Yep. Oh, fourth generation wristband, folks. We're changing the wine world. Oh, there you go. It's good. Oh, you saw that was nice. This, my friends, this may be the coolest wristband I've ever seen. I can hit Mott from here. Mott. Oh. That hit him right in the hand. What are you talking about? Which I thought was quite cute. Now, do the Zork now. And also, welcome to Wine Library TV. Enjoy your family. Enjoy your weekend. Devastated about the New York Jets.
How do you feel about getting the corks thrown at you?
He knows I'm not throwing it at him. I'm throwing it at the
Vayner. Ah, okay.
Go, and go to the Super Bowl. With a little bit of me, Serious Thunder, a.k.a.
What is the best bubbles you ever put in your mouth? It could be Seltzerbot. You. With a little bit of me, oh, we are changing the wine world.
Link that up, Vaynerchuk!